songs of worship and remain standing to the glory of my God. The winds and the waves are no match for our God.
Christ is Jesus who made us and calms the storm.
In the midst of the storms of our lives,
let us calm our minds and worship God with gladness.
Let's pray together.
Teach us, the Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward. Save that and know that we do your will, through Jesus Christ.
in forgiveness and remission of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Alleluia.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Alleluia.
Thank you.
We have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown, and yet are well, as dying and see. We are alive as punished, and yet not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak as to children. Open wide your hearts also. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the Alleluia.
Truly, you are indeed our rock, our strength, and our only refuge. start with the gospel, and then the lectionary texts surround it, with one exception. The epistle lesson doesn't correlate with the gospel. Now, sometimes we let the Old Testament go off in its own direction, but this summer I am using what we call complementary. So what happens is you start with the gospel lesson, what's being said there, and then you find in the Old Testament a complementary text. And then the Psalter or the Psalm responds to the Old Testament reading. So it's Old Testament, respond to that reading with the Psalm that lines up with that as best it can be done. Most of the time it's pretty close, but it was really close. We'll see in a minute. And then you have the epistle lesson, which sometimes goes with the gospel, especially during the thematic time of the year, like, you know, during Lent or Easter or something like that. But now it's kind of off on its own. It's kind of like called semi-continuous. You're just going through the book. Right? So we're in 2 Corinthians right now, so we're just going through that a little bit. So it's kind of off to the side. So put the gospel together. Now, this text, then another part of this is the way we interpret. And it's really easy. I hear a lot of what we call hermeneutics, bad hermeneutics about texts. This text is not about us. Okay? And we always want to do that. Because what's in it for me, right? You gotta whip them. That's it. What's in it for me? That's what whip means, right? And so marketing and they do all that kind of stuff, right? They say that's what you have to do. And so you come to the text and you go, okay, this is a story about Jesus, but what's in it for me? And so he says, well, he calms the troubled sea. So therefore, when I am experiencing something in my life that is troubling and distressing, then Jesus calms that just like he calmed the troubled sea. I can't tell you how many times I've heard that. And it's absolutely true that that's true. But it has nothing to do with this text. And the danger is that what we do is make the text what we want it to be. We read into it. And if you're ready for this, there's a word for that. It's called eisegesis. When we read into the text, exegesis is when we read out of the text and say, what is the text telling us? Now, I think what I'm going to attempt to do is show you how it's better to do exegesis and say, let's see what's being told here. And we'll come up for the reason why Jesus can calm our troubled sea. Not because of this, but because of who he is. And to understand that, we have to understand what's going on in the Gospel of Mark. So, the opening words of Mark, which, by the way, we think is the first gospel, so this may be the first time that this kind of literature has ever been written, a thing called a gospel. This is the gospel of Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus the Anointed One, Jesus the King, all of those are synonymous, the Son of God. That's what he starts out with. That's what this is. This is the glad tidings, the royal proclamation. That's what gospel is. This royal proclamation about this person, Jesus of Nazareth, who is the Christ, the King, the Anointed One, the Messiah, Son of God. Well, now we have to say, why would you say that? What evidence is there? What's going on? And so what Mark is doing is now presenting the case. And he's going to go through the first 8 chapters of his gospel, which we, by the way, 28. So he didn't do it, but we do it. We look at it now and we go, okay, well, this is the case being made. And so it comes to that point in chapter 8. We hear these words as they're gathered together at Caesarea Philippi, which is a city in way in the north. Okay? And they say, by the way, I got a question for you. Jesus says to his 12 there, I got a question for you. Who do men say that I am? And the response that comes back is, well, some say you are Elijah, like the great prophet Elijah that you kind of come back, redo, right? Not they don't believe in reincarnation, but, you know, there was Elijah, and now here you go. It's Elijah in this role of Elijah again. Or a great prophet. But what about you? Who do you say that I am? And then Peter strikes up with the answer that these 8 chapters have been building up to, right? You are the Christ, the Son of God. Yes. So all these 8 chapters, we're building up to that. And this text is going to fall into that. All right, By the way, then he goes on to say, well, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen to the Christ. He's going to go to Jerusalem. He's going to be turned over to the hands of sinful men, and he's going to suffer and die. And Peter says, oh, no, that's not going to happen. We're not going to let that happen. And Peter, or Jesus rebukes Peter and says, get behind me and say, you're not on the side of God, but of man. You're not following the plan. You're making decisions which are not yours to make. And then he goes on to talk about servanthood, what the Messiah has to do, this idea of suffering inside. And then you get the rest of those eight verse chapters. So first eight, the second eight are about the last week of Jesus' life and how he goes to Jerusalem, how he suffers, that he dies, that he raises from death and demonstrates beyond a shadow of doubt that he is the great King, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, the Messiah. So now we have this verse. And lo and behold, if we look at the passage from Psalm 107, and listen to this, and just think of what has taken place here with Jesus. He's on the sea, the winds come up, overwhelm the boat, and then he speaks to the sea and he calms him. So the psalmist writes, some went down to the sea in ships, doing business on the great waters. They saw the deeds of Yahweh, his wondrous works in the deep. For he commanded and raised the stormy sea wind, which lifted up the waves of the sea. They mounted up to heaven. They went down to the depths. This wonderful image, right? Up and down to the seas. Their courage melted in their evil plight, that is, the sailors. They reeled and staggered like drunken men and were at their wits' end. They cried to Yahweh in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He made the storm still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad because they had fight and brought them to their desired haven. Who did that? Yahweh did it. Yahweh, the God of Israel. The one who called Israel into being. The one who created the heavens and the earth. Oh, by the way, this harkens back to Genesis chapter 1. A wonderful creation story. And so what you have is the creation's beginning. You have this firmament, this water between the heavens. It's all around. And then God separates that. And then there's the water in the heavens, and there's the water on the earth, but there's chaos. There's waters over everything. It's all around the world. And you can imagine just everything submerged by water. The great chaos is the way the biblical writers look at it. And then God separates the seas and the dry land. And now you have the possibility for life, because as he does this, then vegetation comes forth from the earth. And then God continues with the creative activity of doing birds and fish, and then land animals, and then finally human life on the sixth day. And he looks at everything and says it is good. This wonderful story. Now, let's go back to Job, right? So that was Psalm 107, we read that, where he calmed the sea. Job, interesting book. But why this passage that is chosen? Because Job is questioning God about what's going on in his life. And he says, this isn't fair. Of course, it's not. It isn't right that I'm suffering this way. I haven't done anything to deserve that. And so now he says, I want my day in court. I want to present my case before the Almighty. I want to say to God, why is it this way? And why it shouldn't be this way? And I don't deserve that. And then God speaks in Job 30. It's a wonderful passage. He goes, I have a little question for you. Where were you when I put all this together? Where were you when I formed the seeds? And that's where this comes in. And the water had separated and caused and said, I put up the boundary and said, you can go this far and no further. Where were you when I did that? And it'll continue on this way. And Job finally would go, with no answer to his question,
what they mean.
I recently was on a cruise on Lake Michigan. It was a kind of a big pontoon boat called the Big Boat. It was in Chicago. And so we were out on the lake, and everybody made fun of me. I don't think that was right. Because just as I got up, I was walking started like this, and of course, I was getting ready to go down onto the ground because, onto the boat floor, because it was wobbly, and they would say, oh, you don't have a sea legs and all that, which it was really pretty pathetic because I noticed that the crew kept, they were just walking like there was nothing going on, right? It's an amazing thing, the lake, right? It looks nice and calm until you get out there. And it was a calm day, no problem. It wasn't like last. And then we eventually got into the Chicago River. Thank God for that, so, because that was easy to navigate, right? But one of the things you'll discover about people who are out of the lake and know it, they're afraid of it. They know how treacherous it is. And they're checking the conditions and know what happens when the wind blows and what happens when, oh, there's a weather system coming in, and they don't want to get caught out. Even though their knowledge is great and they understand, and it's precisely because their knowledge is great and they understand it, that they fear it. Just as those fishermen with Jesus understood and feared it. So that when the waves came up, and they were terrified because they understood what was going to happen because they had seen it happen before. And now Jesus does what Yahweh did in creating the world, separating the waters, causing the land to form and life to come. And now in Psalm 107, as God is with the sailors, as they're out on the sea, and the terrifying storm comes up, and he says, be still, be calm. What do you get there? You get a direct correlation between this one who's sleeping on the boat and the God of Israel. There's no greater way to explain it. You know, sometimes people say, well, it never really says, or Jesus doesn't ever claim to be the Son of God. There it is. Over and over, and those kind of examples is that when we know the story, we understand that what's being said here is this one, lying asleep in the boat, is the great God of heaven and earth. He's of that magnitude. Sleeping in a boat, that's what's scandalous. How is the great God of heaven and earth sleeping in a boat? But he comes to be one of us and identifies with us. So now, okay, with that in mind, right? Now you understand how we make the identification of Jesus. Now we can say, yes, when I'm facing my troubled seas in my life, it is this one who can speak the word to the troubled sea as God incarnate, as the one who, like Yahweh, spoke to the seas and said, be still, be calm, like the one who caused the waters to be separated in the first place. The one who's totally in control. This one speaks the word of grace to me. This one provides my way out of the chaos I find myself in. This one causes me to be able to survive in the midst of great chaos, despair, disillusionment, and defeat. That's why, as we read the epistle, that's why we don't have to be afraid of all this. That's why we can have confidence in the face of it. But it's not a confidence based on, oh, well, everything's going to be all right, and behind every dark cloud there's a silver lining. It's rather because the one who speaks for us is on our side. In Romans chapter 8, which is I always say which is my favorite chapter, but I think it's wrong. Paul's making this tremendous argument, and he throws this line out there, which you think about it, makes all the sense in the world. If God is for us, who can be against us? If the God who calms the troubled sea is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but willingly gave him up for us all, Paul says, will he not also through him give us all that we need? God's on my side. What do I have to fear? Now, whatever comes to me in my life, actually, he said, but now we're more than conquerors in him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, so he's going on and on, right? Nor anything else in all of creation, even that water, even those troubled seas, nothing in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Absolutely magnificent. But it's based upon who Jesus is. It's based upon who Jesus reveals himself to be, the one who comes to us as one of us, but who comes from the one who created us and caused it all to be. And so our confidence is based not in the story, not in an event, but in the one who stands behind us, all the stories, and all the events, and all the difficulties of this world, even Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. I want to tell you, I found this, I got another prayer book. Love prayer books. And so this is the Sunday morning prayer that he came up with. The author's name is Cornelius Plantinga. And it's a Sunday prayer. Good God, today on 7 continents, innumerable congregations will worship you. In thousands of languages, they will offer prayers of praise, confession, thanksgiving, a lament, petition, intercession, dedication. They will hear your word, receive portions of the loaf and cup, give their gifts, sing your praise, witness baptism, and hear that their sins are forgiven and that they are right with you. Many will worship online. Worshippers will include children, teens, young adults, middle-aged folks, and the elderly. They will be new Christians, veteran Christians, and not a few almost Christians trying out worship for the first time. Most will be mindful that you are our incomparable superior, our great creator, redeemer, and guide for life. Oh God, those of us who worship would feel pains if we abstain. Worship completes and fulfills us. More important, worship is for us right and fitting and proper. It reaffirms our place in your universe. It acknowledges our deep and sheer dependence on you. It's fitting for us to praise you for your creative energy that has dug out of the depths, the oceans, and built in the strength of the hills. For your generous rains that moisten and soften the earth, and for sunshine after rain that causes a part of your beauty to come across the earth in blooms and vines and trees and frogs. Above all, it is entirely fitting for us to thank you for the great salvation you have worked for us in the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. O God, we look forward to the new heaven and earth that will stretch gloriously forward for eternity. Your justice will at last prevail over darkness. Your harmony will at last dispel chaos. Your peace will at last quiet unrest. And your love will at last wipe away all tears. Then all nations and tribes and peoples will gather before you to acclaim your goodness and your mighty salvation. Every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to your glory, to your everlasting glory, forever and ever. Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and affirm our faith in the words of the recitation of the Nicene Creed. Let us confess the faith of the one holy Catholic that is universal and apostolic faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all And you set before us the way of life in your great Torah, your great instructions. You spoke of love and justice in the prophets. And in the Word made flesh, you lived among us, manifesting your glory. Christ died that we might live, and is risen to raise us to new life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your most holy name.
Hallelujah! Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven, take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation, take and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you. Amen.
Thank you. pray, and we won't know for about 3 months when he will finally be off antibiotics, whether it is in fact got rid of the terrible infection that he's had in his sinuses for 3 years now. So it's damaging his lungs, and we just really pray for healing from him.
Absolutely. And Joy?
Well, it was that he didn't
have that. Oh,
okay. Yeah. Well, I was hoping for more.
But that's good. And any others? Well, let's begin by singing to the Lord.
Kelly?
Oh, April? Who did I miss? Oh, Kathy, wait a minute. Something in the chair.
Prayers for a friend of ours, husband. He's fighting scoliosis of the liver, and he's on the list for a liver transplant. And we're praying for him to get that liver soon, if God wills that. And just prayers for him in the meantime as he goes through his battle.
And what's his name, Ken?
His name's Ron.
Ron?
Yeah.
Well, we'll keep Ron in our prayers.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Did I miss anybody? Okay, now we will sing to the Lord.
Thank you.
our blessings and to proclaim the goodness of God through all of our offerings. May all that we give be a testimony to God's purpose among us and a testimony to his unfailing love for mankind. Let us now gather all of those offerings together and joyfully present them to the Lord.
Thank you.
blessing of the Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with each of you and remain in your hearts now and evermore. Amen. Go in love and peace.